So INI-CET is done. Question was not much tough, as I can see from my perspective. Very conceptual questions, lot of repeats, though the style was different. Lot of matching questions were asked, lot of multiple answer questions were asked, but very conceptual. As per Obs GYN, I can tell you that whosoever has framed the question is a very smart person, very smartly framed questions. Only 9 questions were there, but yes, very nice questions. Anybody who will be knowing the concept clearly will get the question. Otherwise, if you are just marking based on your common sense, then you might have screwed it up. We will know further once we will discuss the questions. I am Dr. Shefali Tyagi, and let's start with the INI-CET OBGY questions, right? So the first question was, if a nurse witnesses the umbilical cord coming out of vagina in a term pregnant woman, what is the most appropriate step that nurse should do? Options were, gently push the cord back, ask the patient to lie in Trendelenburg position, inform that patient needs to be shifted for delivery immediately, do a vaginal examination to know the presentation. What have you marked the answer? Okay, just hold it there. And if I ask you what is the most important word in this question, then what it will be? Cord prolapse, you all must have read, you must all be knowing the management. The most important word here is a nurse witnessed the cord, umbilical cord prolapse. So it's not a doctor, it's not you, it's nurse. So you have to answer accordingly that what a nurse will do. Okay, so among all these options, once you have witnessed an umbilical cord prolapse, you have to deliver the baby. Baby is at very high risk, you have to deliver it. How will you deliver it? If the patient is in advanced second stage of labor, then put the instrument and take out the baby. And if the patient is in early stage, take her for cesarean. So the first step which you need to know as a doctor is at which stage of labor she is. So the first step which you have to do once you have seen the umbilical cord prolapse is do the PV. Do the PV and see where in which stage of labor the patient is, and then decide the management then and there. So if the question would have asked that you have witnessed the umbilical cord prolapse, answer would have been do a vaginal examination immediately and know the presentation. But it is a nurse. So nurse is not authorized to do a vaginal examination, right? So what else can be done? If you have done the vaginal examination and you see that she is in early stage of labor, the first step, if the question tells you that she is in early stage of labor, first step is make arrangements for the OT. You have to immediately make arrangements for the OT. That is the first step. And in the meanwhile, you will do all the procedures to avoid cord compression, right? So if question would have given you that she is in early stage of labor and she has underwent a cord prolapse, then answer would have been inform the patient she needs to be shifted for delivery immediately. Then the answer would have been that. But it is again not given. It is given what a nurse will do. You don't know the stage yet. So nurse will do the maneuver to avoid the cord compression. This is all what a nurse can do, and then she'll call the doctor. So these above two methods must seem to you like they are the method to avoid cord compression, correct? But the option A, gently push the cord back, is not a method to avoid cord compression. This is absolute no. Everywhere, all the book, all the guidelines, pushing the cord back will not prevent the cord compression. It is the Trendelenburg position which will prevent cord compression. So this is your answer. Alright, I'll give you the reference. Let's study cord prolapse in little detail, because now in next NEET, further question might be asked on it. So what is cord prolapse? It is defined as descent of umbilical cord beyond cervix. That is cord prolapse. It could be beside the presenting part. It means just lying beside the presenting part or beyond the presenting part. On this basis, it is of three types. One is occult cord prolapse. Occult cord prolapse means cord is lying beside the head. It has not come beyond the head. Next is cord presentation. Cord presentation is cord lying between the cervix and the fetal membranes. When the fetal membranes are intact and you are doing a PV, you can feel the cord instead of head. That is cord presentation. It is not prolapse. Prolapse is when the membranes have ruptured and the loops of the cord come out of vagina. That is cord prolapse. So we have three terms: occult cord prolapse, cord presentation, and overt cord prolapse. What are the risk factors for cord prolapse? Since a question has been asked on cord prolapse, you should know the risk factors. First and foremost, most important is malpresentation. Breech, transverse, oblique lie. All three malpresentations can lead to cord prolapse. Then hydramnios, preterm delivery, if the baby is small, like preterm, or it is less than 2.5 kg, cord can easily slip through the side of the baby. So preterm, small babies, multiparous lady, and iatrogenic factors. The maneuvers which you do as a doctor can also lead to cord prolapse. So you need to be very careful when you are doing these maneuvers on a pregnant lady, like expected management of PPRM. If a patient has ruptured membranes before her term, the baby must be small, baby must be preterm, and you are managing it expectantly, right? The membranes are ruptured. There are high chances that her cord might prolapse. So expectant management of PPRM, amniotomy. When you artificial rupture the membrane, that is why amniotomy is never done when head is high up or head is not engaged, because it can lead to cord prolapse. Then external Kifrig version, when it is done in breech, intrauterine pressure catheter placement, scalp electrode and amnioreduction. If you can remember this big list, then it is good for you. And I will advise you that please go through the list at least once or twice. So these are the risk factors for cord prolapse. How to avoid? One thing is how to manage. But at least you should know how to avoid so that this fatal thing does not happen. I'll give you three important points then how to avoid cord prolapse. First is, whenever patient has malpresentation, transverse lie, oblique lie, unstable lie, admit her after 37 weeks. Once she has completed her 37 weeks, admit her, advise her admission. Why? Because if she goes in labor, there are high chances of cord prolapse, and at least she is in hospital so that you can manage her then and there. Right? So advise admission after 37 weeks to all the malpresentations. Then artificial rupture of membrane is never done when head is high and not engaged. In a floating head, it is never done. And when, if you are doing a PV examination, membranes are intact and you feel cord, it means it is cord presentation, right? It is, then you avoid rupturing membrane. That is very obvious, avoid rupturing membrane. And how to manage such a patient? When she is in labor, when a cord presentation patient is in labor, take her up for cesarean, because as soon as the membranes will ruptured, then patient will have cord prolapse, right? So these are the three maneuvers by which you can avoid cord prolapse. Now the main question, how to manage? So it's an obstetric emergency. It has a very high fetal mortality, right? So why the mortality is high? The main reason is cord compression. Whenever the cord has come out of the vagina, the cord gets compressed between the fetal head and pelvis. This cord compression, besides that, a loops lying outside, in the outside environment, they very tend to have vasospasm. So this cord compression and vasospasm lead to obstruction of the blood flow from the fetus. This leads to fetal mortality. So the main aim is to deliver the baby as soon as possible. Do not wait, deliver the baby. Now, how to deliver the baby will depend on which stage of labor the patient is. If she is in advanced labor, then expedite the delivery. It means put the instrument, be it vacuum, be it forceps, and take out the baby, right? If she is in early stage, she is not in advanced stage of labor, at least once look for the fetal heart. You have to deliver the baby immediately, but how much time do you have, you can know by fetal heart. If fetal heart is okay, you still have time. She is category 2 LSCS. But if cord has prolapsed, fetal heart is not good, she has to be taken for cesarean immediately, category 1 LSCS. It means she has to be delivered within 30 minutes of diagnosis. In this 30 minutes, you have to make all the arrangement, take the consent, shift the patient and take out the baby. So category 1 LSCS means take out the baby within 30 minutes, right? So this is how you deliver the baby. So if we revise, when patient is in second stage of labor, do the instrumental delivery. When cord prolapse is diagnosed before full dilatation, be it 8, be it 9, it doesn't matter. You will not wait for full dilatation. If cord prolapse before full dilatation, assistants should immediately call for preparations of birth in theater. This is what your RCOG green top guidelines say. This is the exact line from there, that first step, if patient is not in full dilatation, is call the assistants for immediate preparation of the theater for delivery of the baby, right? So this will be your first step. In the meanwhile, till the baby is being delivered, right, till you are shifting the patient to the operation theater, you'll do few steps to avoid cord compression. What are those few steps? First is lift the fetal head manually. So it is not lifting the cord loops, it is the lifting of fetal head. Lift the fetal head so that the compression which is occurring between the fetal head and the pelvis, that is relieved. So the maneuver which you have to do is fetal head lifting. other than that, what you can do is Foley. You can fill the bladder using Foley catheter up to 500 to 750 ml. When bladder is filled, it will lift the head immediately itself, and again the cord compression will be relieved. This is called as Vago's method on the scientist who discovered it. So you can do either Vago method or you can lift the fetal head manually, any one of them. Another thing is, put the patient in Nietzsche's position or Trendelenburg when head is positioned down, or an exaggerated Sims position. These three maneuvers will also help in relieving cord compression. Tocolytics is the last. So first option has to be by lifting the fetal head, then the positions, and in the last, if the fetal heart is not good, you can try tocolytics to relax the uterus, okay, in the third option. So this is from RCOG guideline number 50. For all what you must be thinking, and I've seen a lot of teachers are telling you the answer, that the cord should be put back in vagina. For all those, I have put it what other guidelines say. INI-CET book on page 534 clearly says reduction of cord as was practiced earlier is not recommended, as it will unlikely relieve the cord compression. What the RCOG says, there are insufficient data to evaluate manual replacement of prolapsed cord above the presenting part, right? So the answer is, gently push the cord back, absolutely no. Since it's a nurse who witnessed it, she cannot do the PV, which has to be the first step. She cannot do the PV. She cannot tell you whether she has to deliver in labor room or the cesarean. She cannot tell. What she can do is put her in the Trendelenburg position immediately. So this is what your answer is. Next question, identify the position of fetal head. Very, very easy. See, the occiput, first tell me the lie. The lie is longitudinal, right? It is kyphlic presentation, head is down. Seems fully flexed, right? So this occiput, this is the occiput. It is lying anteriorly near pubic symphysis. So definitely occiput to posterior positions, these options are gone. Now, which side of the patient it is? Patient is lying in front of you, right? So this is patient's right and this is patient's left, right? So this is right occiput to anterior. Easy? Repeat question, you all must have marked it right. Now identify the grip by maneuver shown below. Again, a repeat and a very easy question. What is this? Hands put beside the baby. So this is the umbilical grip. I'm not very sure that what photograph was given. Some students were saying that it was fundal, some were saying umbilical. We'll know further if we'll know all the grips. So the first grip is fundal grip, when hands are put on uterine fundus. So hands are put on uterine fundus. Remember that for fundal grip, hands are not touched. It is not this. Fundal grip is like this. They are kept separate, but hands are put on near the buttock. Near the buttock, when hands are there, it is fundal grip. Hands are separated from each other. What it determines? It helps in determining first the lie, whether it is longitudinal or transverse. If the fundal grip is empty, it most likely the lie is not longitudinal, either transverse or oblique. So it will tell you about the fetal lie, and if it is longitudinal, it will tell you which presentation it is. If you are feeling a soft, broad mass, it means this area is breech. Below, near the pelvis is head. It is kyphlic presentation and otherwise round. So it will tell you the presentation and the fetal lie. First, fundal grip. Second is umbilical grip. Hands are again placed separately away from each other, but now hands are lying near the back and the limbs. In the first grip, the hands are near the buttocks, but here it's on the back and the limbs. So that is the umbilical grip, when hands are placed besides the umbilicus of the patient. What will it determine? It determines the fetal position. How? If the back is on the left side like here, then same is the site of occiput. So whether it is right occiput or left side occiput, you will know by seeing where is the back, where are the limbs. Like soft smooth curve is back, small knobby parts are the limbs. So it will tell you the orientation, position and orientation of fetus. Third grip is polygrip. I've told you in crash course also, polygrip is how to remember when you're making hand like a paw. Like a paw, you make your hand and put it on pubic symphysis here. Then you can feel whether it is head or breech part which you are feeling. So what it tells you, the third grip, it confirms all the findings which you discovered in first grip. First, it will tell you whether it is longitudinal lie or not. If it is empty, polygrip is empty, it means the lie is not longitudinal. Then it will tell you what is the presenting part. if you can feel a hard globular mass which is slightly tender to move. Why tender? Head being so hard, when it strikes the pelvis, it is a little tender. So a hard globular mass tender to move is head, and if it is soft and broad, it is breech. So it will tell you the lie and the presentation. That is polygrip. Fourth is the pelvic grip. In all the above three grips, you were facing the patient, right? But now in fourth grip, you are facing the patient's pelvis. So when you are facing the patient's pelvis, it is the fourth grip or the pelvic grip. You put both the hands on the symphysis pubis. What are you trying to know? You are trying to know the descent of the fetal head inside the pelvis. So you will know the degree of descent of fetal head in the pelvis. So this is the pelvic grip. I hope you must have got your answer. Next question was on modified Robson's C-section criteria. So I don't know what the question was, but I will love to have, if you can tell me in the comment box what the question exactly was, I can give you a more clear-cut answer. Up till now, what I know is that question was asked on Robson's C-section criteria. Very much out of box question. If you have not marked it correct, if you have left it, it is okay. You are expected to. We don't expect you to know this Robson's criteria, but now the question has been asked, so you must know for the NEET PG exam. In 2015, WHO proposed this Robson's criteria, also called as 10 group classification. Why? See, WHO saw that cesarean section rate has suddenly been booming up. It's increasing a lot. So they created this criteria to monitor and compare, assess, monitor and compare, right? To assess the cesarean section rate, monitor them, and to compare them between the patients in these criteria and between the healthcare facilities also. If you will make a table, a big table of these 10 criteria, and you will put women into them, you will know which category women has underwent maximum cesarean and which hospital is doing maximum cesarean for which indication. So to compare the cesarean section rate between healthcare facilities and between the patients, this criteria was launched in 2015. Okay, there were certain modifications done which were easy modifications, which I will tell you. So what were the variables they used? They used 2 maternal variables, 3 fetal variables. So what are the maternal variables? What is the parity? And in which stage of labor she is? Is she in labor or not? So gestational age and the labor. About fetus, they used what? Very normal things. What is the gestational age? What is the lie of the fetus? And how many fetuses are there? Okay, gestational age, lie of the fetus, how many fetuses are there? So parity and onset of labor, maternal criteria, and gestational age, fetal presentation, and number of fetus. These for fetus. So these 5 variables were used to make these 10 classifications. They must seem exhaustive to you, but they are not. Once we'll go through it, you'll know that they are pretty easy. So class 1 was a very easygoing patient. Nulli para, term pregnancy more than 37 weeks, single, kyphlic, in spontaneous labor. Most important word here is she is in spontaneous labor. Category 2, same patient, she is nulli para, she is term pregnancy, kyphlic, single fetus, but she has not come in labor. Either you induced the labor or she underwent cesarean section before labor, right? So nulli para, more than 37 weeks, induced labor, or you have done C-section currently in her before labor. Important point, if a patient comes to you, same nulli para, single kyphlic, at in labor, and you did cesarean section in labor only for something like cord prolapse. So she got cord prolapse at 4 cm and you did cesarean section. She'll be in what category? She'll be in category 1 because she came in spontaneous labor and you did CS in the labor. So that will be category 1. Here it is CS before labor. Okay. Class 3 is similar patient, but she is multipara. So multipara, term pregnancy, single, kyphlic, spontaneous labor. Again, class 4 same, multipara, term, single, kyphlic, either you induced the labor or you did the cesarean section before labor. Okay, so these are easy, class 1 to 4. Class 5 is multipara with term pregnancy, single kyphlic, but previous CS. Okay, up till now, these were nulli para. In these multipara, we never mentioned what was the previous obstetric history. Class 5 include every multipara with previous cesarean section. Okay, so these are class 1 to 5, easy, right? Similar kind of classes, I have put them together. Now class 6 to 10, you can see that class 6 to 10 does not mention term pregnancy. Why? Because there are little complicated pregnancies. Class 6 is all the nulliparas, single breech. First of all, important, single baby, breech. If a patient comes to you at 34 weeks and she is breech, which category she will be in? She will be in class 6. It does not mention period of gestation, but the baby has to be single. Okay, class 7, simple. Multipara, single, breech. It also includes the previous caesarean scar. So, previous scar also is included in class 7. Class 8, all the women with multiple pregnancy. Whether she is primipara, whether she is multipara, whether she had previous caesarean, all the twin pregnancy is, twin or triplet, is in class 8. Okay, class 9 is single pregnancy with oblique or transverse line. So, single, oblique or transverse lie, right? That is in class 9 with or without previous CS, it doesn't matter. So, class 9 includes all the multipara, all the nullipara with transverse or oblique lie. Okay, class 10 is preterm, single, kyphlic, preterm, but it is kyphlic. That's what I was telling, a patient comes to you at 34 weeks with breech. So, she could be class 10 or class 6. So, class 10 is kyphlic preterm. Anybody who is breech, period of gestation doesn't matter. She has to be in class 6. Okay. Breech 30 weeks, 34 weeks, 35 weeks has to be in class 6. Okay. Similarly, I tell you one more example. All the women with multiple pregnancy is in class 8. So, if a patient comes to you with twin pregnancy, first baby being breech, second being kyphlic, where will you put it? You will put it in 6 or 8. You'll put it in 8. All the multiple pregnancy, because this is single breech. All the multiple pregnancy is in class 8, no matter what the lie is. Then another condition, a patient comes to you at term pregnancy with face presentation. What will be the class? Will it be class 9? No. Head is down, though head is not flexed. That is why she is face, or she might be brow presentation. She'll be class 1. Class 9 is when there is lie is different, it is oblique or transverse, right? If she is head presentation, then she will be class 1. Okay, another condition, if a patient comes to you with twin and she had vanishing twin, so one of the twin vanished at 12 weeks, now she comes to you with single live pregnancy, where will you put it? You will not put it in class 8, she is not multiple pregnancy, she lost her baby before 20 weeks, so she had an abortion, we will say vanishing twin. She will be, when she presented to you, she was single live intrauterine fetus, so she will be class 1. Similarly, if this patient comes to you, this twin pregnancy at 34 weeks with one fetus died 2 days back, you did the ultrasound, you realize that fetus has expired just 2 to 3 days back, then what you category it will be? Then it will be multiple pregnancy. So, when the fetus has died after 20 weeks, intrauterine fetus has died after 20 weeks, that is class 8. If the fetus has vanished before 20 weeks, that is class 1. Okay. So, these are the conditions. What else? Yeah. So, if a patient comes to you full term breech, you did the external kyphlic version and the baby is now kyphlic. Now, she went into labor after 2 days. What will it be? It will be class 1 or will it be class 6. See, when patient presented to you in labor, she was kyphlic. So, the final presentation of patient was kyphlic. No matter, you did the version, but she was kyphlic. So, she will be class 1. She will not be class 6. Okay. So, I have told you these conditions because I exactly don't know what the question was. But please, if any one of you remember the options, just put it down. Now, what is the modification which has been done? Modified Robson's criteria. It's very simple. They have classified class 2, 4 and 5. How? They say that induced labor and C-section before labor, let's separate it. 2A is those in which you induced labor, and 2B is which underwent C-section before labor. Okay, similarly class 4, same condition, multipara. 4A is when you induced the labor and 4B is when she underwent section before labor. Class 5, multipara with caesarean section. So, class 5A is past LSCS, how many? 1. And 5B is past caesarean, more than 1. Simple. So, this was the modified Robson's criteria, exhaustive list, but easy to remember. The conditions I have told you, in what condition, which category you will put her into. So I hope you will remember that. Okay. Next question. Suman is having recurrent trichomonas infection. She was advised pap smear. What should be explained to Suman? Pap is screening for cervical cancer. Pap is diagnostic of trichomonas. Pap smear tells whether patient has cancer cervix or not. Pap detects reproductive tract cancer. So, answer must be simple, right? Pap is a screening for cervical cancer. Rest all options cannot be true. That's what you must be thinking. No, absolutely no. Except C. C is totally wrong. It is not diagnostic of cancer cervix. B and C are partially correct. That is why I want to know if this was multiple choice answer. Answer will be A, B and D. If the question asked except, answer will be C. But if they ask you the single right answer, the best answer is pap smear is screening cervical cancer. Though B and D are not wrong. They are not the best answer, but they are not wrong. How? I tell you. So what is pap smear? It's a cytological screening test for detecting cervical cancer. So basically it is a test for cervical cancer screening. That is why how it was developed. What do? You take the exfoliative cells from ectocervix and endocervix using a IR spatula, put it on a slide, and what is the fixator? You must be knowing 95% ethanol, right? And then it is seen by a cytologist under the microscope. Now the sensitivity is low, of almost 50%. You almost miss 50% of cases. But when you have diagnosed cervical cancer on pap smear, it is very specific. Then you have to do the confirmatory test. So sensitivity is low, it might miss few cases, but the specificity is very high. Okay, so what all it can detect? Obviously, it can detect epithelial abnormalities. That's what its function is. It can detect squamous cell abnormalities and glandular. In squamous, how the reporting of pap smear is done? According to Bethesda classification, they label squamous cell abnormalities as atypical squamous cells of undetermined significance, low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion, high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion, and squamous cell cancer. So, squamous cell abnormalities are labeled as into these four categories. When there is glandular abnormality, it is labeled as atypical endocervical glandular cells. They mention that, or they mention benign or atypical endometrial cells. So, pap smear can also see the endometrial cells. Though it is not for endometrial cancer screening, but if pap smear shows atypical endometrial cells, you have to do the DNC to rule out endometrial cancer. Right? So, it might detect it, right? Though it is not used for that purpose. What about vaginal intraepithelial lesions? Yes, it can also detect vein. I'll tell you later how. Similarly, like endometrial cancer, it is not used for detecting that cancer. But it on pap smear, by chance, you can also detect vein. You can also detect endometrial cancers. Regarding vaginal intraepithelial neoplasias, see, vein is always accompanied by CIN, nearly always. Whenever there is vaginal intraepithelial neoplasia, CIN will be there. In fact, some says it is the extension of CIN into vagina which you are detecting. So, cytology is always positive in vein. Whenever you are doing vein, cytology will come positive. Women with persistently abnormal pap smear and you have evaluated cervix, it is normal. Then you always check for vein. How? Via colposcopy. Right. So, persistently abnormal pap smear with normal cervix, you should always think of vein. Okay. So, it is not wrong to say that pap smear does not detect vaginal lesions. It is not used for detecting vaginal intraepithelial neoplasias. It is not used for detecting endometrial hyperplasias, but it might help in detecting them. If it shows some positive signs, you have to think about it. You cannot just let it go. Similarly, what all other things it can detect? In reporting, it can also detect organisms. And yes, it is reported by pathologist in the pap smear. It can clearly see trichomonas. That was asked in the question. It can see trichomonas infection. It is not diagnostic of trichomonas. What is diagnostic of trichomonas? Wet preparation. But it can clearly see trichomonas. It can see fungal organisms consistent with candida. Not candida, it will see. Fungal organisms consistent with candida. Shift in flora suggesting bacterial vaginosis. Bacteria morphologically consistent with actinomyces, cellular changes consistent with herpes. So, it will suggest these. What? It can suggest candida, it can suggest bacterial vaginosis, it can suggest actinomyces, it can suggest herpes. When it suggests all these organisms, you have to do further testing. In case of trichomonas, so it is not used for diagnosis of trichomonas, but when you have seen trichomonas in pap smear, then either treat the patient by seeing the symptom or do the diagnostic test, right? So it can suggest trichomonas also. So it is not completely not related to organism. It is not so. It is actually reported. If you have seen a pap smear report, the cytologist report trichomonas organism seen, right? Other non-neoplastic findings which pap smear can see is inflammation, radiation changes, post-hysterectomy status and atrophy. This all pap smear can report. It is taken from NOVAC's 15th edition. So it is not completely unrelated to reproductive tract cancer. It is not completely unrelated to trichomonas. The person who has made the question has thought something. That is why he has given these options. He has not blindly given you these options, right? So if we, now since they have asked, so I have to tell you a little about trichomonas diagnosis, how the patient presents. In case of trichomonas vaginalis, patient has profuse, purulent, malodorous vaginal discharge. Malodorous means quite smelly vaginal discharge with pruritus. Patchy vaginal erythema, also called as strawberry cervix. Strawberry cervix is also there. Then pH could be variable. pH variable means that pH generally ranges more than 5. Obviously, acidic pH is protective to women and alkaline pH will increase the organism infestation. What is the only organism in which you will have acidic pH? Candida, right? So, in Candida, pH will be still acidic. In trichomonas and all other infections, pH is alkali. Microscopy reveal motile trichomonas and this is diagnostic, wet preparation. Clue cells you can find how, because clue cells is basically seen in bacterial vaginosis. Trichomonas is almost always associated with bacterial vaginosis. So you can find clue cells and VIF test positive. It is also diagnostic, right? So this is trichomonas infection. Now, if we get back to the question, Suman is having trichomonas. She is advised pap smear. Pap is screening for cervical cancer? True. Diagnostic for trichomonas? Yes, it can diagnose for trichomonas, but it is not diagnostic. So I don't know what the term was, but it can detect trichomonas, right? It can suggest trichomonas. And when it suggests trichomonas, you have to treat the patient. So it is partially correct. Let's put a question mark. Pap smear tells whether patient has cancer cervix or not. Totally wrong. Pap detects reproductive tract cancer. Yes, it can detect endometrial cancer and can also detect vaginal intraepithelial neoplasias. Not used for these cancers, it can detect them. So this is also partially correct. So if the question was single choice answer, answer will be A. It was multiple choice, answer will be A, B and D. I would love to if you can tell me in comment box what the choices were. Next is, all are true about breech delivery except breech identified for the first time during delivery is a contraindication for normal labor. For breech delivery, continuous FHR monitoring is done. Breech delivery is done where emergency CS facility is available. Breech delivery is undertaken at a center where birth attendant skilled in breech delivery is available. Now, this kind of question you can answer by your common sense, that obviously for breech delivery, it's a high risk pregnancy. FHR monitoring has to be done. You have to do it in a center where the CS facilities are available. Obviously, it's a high risk pregnancy and where somebody is available who is skilled for breech delivery. So, your answer will be clearly this. Let's study about breech. So, incidence of breech, it has been asked in past the question 3%, right? If a person already had a breech delivery, chances of recurrence are 10%, right? If a patient presents you with breech, the first thing which you have to do is always, unless contraindicated, in all the patient, try external kyphilic version. Okay, so trying external kyphilic version is something which you should offer to every patient. When? At more than 36 weeks. At more than 36 weeks, you have to offer external kyphilic version unless contraindicated. So factors which will, you can very safely deliver breech patients normally, but the conditions which will decide whether she will be having cesarean or not are these 9 factors, right? First is very, very obvious lack of operator experience. If you don't have an operator who knows how to deliver a breech vaginally, why will you underwent? Why will you let the lady underwent through it, right? So lack of operator experience. Then fetal causes. What are the fetal causes? If the baby is too large, you will not deliver her. If the baby is too small, you will not deliver her breech. So large fetus, healthy viable preterm fetus. Why healthy viable? Because if it's very, it's not viable. If it's 800 gram fetus, you will not do cesarean for that. So healthy viable preterm fetus, severe IUGR. Okay. So very big baby, very small baby, you will not deliver vaginally. Then incomplete or footling presentation. Incomplete breech, or you can say footling presentation, is an indication for cesarean. Another thing is extended head, also called as stargazing fetus. So stargazing, as if he is gazing the stars. So stargazing fetus, hyperextended head is also an indication for cesarean. Then the maternal prerequisites which will decide that breech has to be delivered or not. Obviously contracted pelvis. Then if she had previous cesarean. If she had previous cesarean, you will not deliver this breech. And then patient requesting for cesarean, obvious. So these are the 9 factors which will decide whether the breech should be delivered normally or via LSCS. Important points: induction of labor, is breech patient at term induced? No. Induction of labor is not advised in case of breech. Augmentation can be done for somebody who has hypotonic contraction, but induction in breech is not advisable. There is high risk of cord prolapse in breech, I have told you already. So fetal heart monitoring has to be continuous in labor in case of breech. Second thing, obviously you will do the breech delivery only a place where there is a room, there is a place to do the cesarean section, because it's a high risk pregnancy, right? So these are the 3 important points. So the answer will be, obviously I have told you, breech identified for the first time during delivery is a contraindication. No, if the baby is of normal size, pelvis is normal, she is not a previous cesarean section, she is not footling, head is not extended, then you will simply let her deliver normally. Okay. Next, HPV vaccines use virus-like protein to generate antibodies against which protein? So, a little tough question, I agree. So, if you have not marked it, it is okay, but you have marked it correct, then very good. Your preparation is going really good. So first we should know what these proteins do. So proteins involved in HPV infections are L1, L2, E1, E2, E6, E7. They are involved in all the different steps of HPV infection. L1, L2 is like, for L, it is saying let me in. So you can remember L1, L2, let me in, infection initiation. Rest, E1, E2 for replication. E6, E7 for malignant transformation. So these are 3 different proteins which are involved in HPV infections. So HPV vaccines, most commonly used as Gardasil vaccines, they are basically the preventive vaccines. If somebody has HPV infection, it cannot treat it. It can only prevent HPV infections. Okay, so for prevention, when they use virus-like proteins, antibodies are generated against which protein? Capsid protein L1. You have to remember this fact. For prevention of HPV, vaccine use L1 proteins to generate antibodies. Now, since the HPV infection rate is so high that only preventive vaccines can't help, we eventually in future have to create therapeutic vaccines which could treat those patients who have already got HPV infection. So therapeutic vaccines are not there right now in the market, but if in future we develop therapeutic vaccines, then they have to generate antibodies against which protein? Against E6 and E7. So this might be asked next time, that therapeutic vaccines, if generated, then they will have to generate immunity against E6 and E7. Why? Because they are the proteins involved in malignant transformation, right? So L1 for preventive vaccines, which are being used currently, and therapeutic vaccines for future use will use E6, E7 proteins. Okay. A little about the vaccines. So we have 3 vaccines in the market: Cervarix, Gardasil quadrivalent, Gardasil nonavalent. Very commonly used now, Gardasil nonavalent. So Cervarix cover HPV subtype 16-18, only high risk. Gardasil 16-18, besides that 6 and 11. It uses 6 and 11 also, which cause genital warts. So it is protective against warts also. Gardasil uses is against 9 HPV subtypes. So Cervarix is protective against only CIN and AIS, right? But Gardasil is again CIN, vaginal intraepithelial neoplasias, vulval intraepithelial neoplasias, anal cancer and genital warts. So it is used for a lot of things. Similarly, Gardasil nonavalent is also for CIN, vein, WIN, and then anal cancers and genital warts. For prevention, it is not for treatment. Recommended in females only, right? But Gardasil is in both males and females. Okay, since warts can happen to anybody. But obviously, cervical cancer and adenocarcinoma in situ can happen in females only, right? Age group in which you have to give the vaccine is, ideal age group is 9 to 26 years. And preferable age group is 11 to 12. So, the range is 9 to 26 years. And when you have to give is 11 to 12 years. Dose is, all of them, 3 doses, 0.5 ml IM, right? Then, at interval of 0, 1 and 6 months. Adjuvant uses aluminium hydroxide in cervarix, in both of them aluminium hydroxyphosphate, because it produces high adjuvant titer. So this is the table where you can revise and you can see what are the difference between the vaccines. The question can be asked in NEET, so just go through the table. Next question, pregnant woman has cramps at night, what will the nurse tell the patient to do? Again, a very unexpected question, but it can be asked based on the, for people who must have attended their gynae OPDs in their internship, they can answer, because a lot of patient comes with cramp in pregnancy. And what we advise is a general exercise. So, on that basis, you can answer. What we advise is dorsiflexion of ankle and knee extension, like this. Dorsiflexion and knee extension. This stretching will help her reduce the cramps. See, leg cramps are very common in pregnancy. Why? Because scientists suspect that the reason might be this. They are not very sure. That there is increase in weight and changes in circulation, okay, in pregnancy. Besides that, pressure of growing baby put pressure on the vessels of the legs. That is why it leads to cramps. So, how to manage cramps? Stretching. Stretching of the exercise of the muscles leads to relaxation. So, knee extension and ankle dorsiflexion is the stretching. Besides that, massage, apply heating pad, drinking lots of water with calcium, phosphate and magnesium, and rest with legs elevated. So, stretching, massage, right, heat pads, high amount of water with calcium, phosphate and magnesium, and resting with legs up. This is a general advice given in gyne obstetrics OPD. Those of you who must have attended the clinics must be knowing all this. The surprising thing is WHO says, now this is from all the other articles, WHO says that stretching does not help. All these methods does not help. Only thing helps in leg cramps is calcium and magnesium. This is what WHO prescribes. That, besides that, American guideline says all this helps, but WHO says it's only calcium and magnesium. I had to tell you so that if question is asked in this regard, what WHO advise, what is the best, then you have to mark this. Best is calcium, potassium, magnesium. Last question. Partogramy started when the cervical dilatation is, all of you must have marked right. And if you have not, then I am very disappointed, but the answer is, I know you must have 4 centimeter. Let's go to the partogram quickly. You all must be very thorough with it. What is partogram? It is graphical representation of progress of labor along with maternal and fetal condition. So, maternal condition, fetal condition and progress of labor, all three are seen in partogram. Modified partogram, plotting starts from 4 centimeter. In old partogram, plotting was from latent phase. Now, the latent phase has been removed. Now, it is started from 4 cm. Active phase of labor, I am telling you again, I have told this you in crash course also. Active phase is from 6 cm, but partogram has not been updated right now. So, it is still from 4 cm. So, alert and action line separated by an interval of how many hours? Yes, 4 hours, right? One small box is of how many hours? One small box is of half an hour. So, this big box is of 1 hour. Again, at which site you should start plotting from? Patient comes to you at 1 o'clock with 6 cm. First plot will be where? First plot will be here? No. First plot will be always on alert line. First plot will be at here at 6 cm. And here only you will mark 1 o'clock. Right? So, it is always on alert line. You must have read at many places. You must have seen at many places that first plot is on the left of alert line. No, it is on the alert line. Why? Because after 4 hours, if the progress is slow, you will know immediately. If it is, progress has to be 1 centimeter per hour according to partogram. If it is even 0.9, it will immediately cross the alert line. And as it crosses the alert line, you know what to do? You have to shift her to the higher center. And you, if she is in higher center, you have to do certain steps to pick her up in her labor process, like see whether the cephalopelvic disproportion is there or not. If it is not, see the contractions. If the contractions are not good, start with oxytocin and see for 4 hours. even if after 4 hours the labor is not good, it means after 4 hours she touches the action line. Now she has to be taken up for cesarean, right? So you have to plot on the alert line always. So I can explain this why, that if suppose you plot it here 6 centimeter, and this is 1 o'clock, then 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. At 5 o'clock, suppose after 4 hours, she is only 9 centimeter. So she comes to be here. Ideally, after 4 hours, she has to be where? She has to be at least 10 centimeter. But now, according to you, if it is plotted here, she is 9 centimeter. She has not dilated 1 centimeter per hour. But has she crossed her alert line? No, because the plotting is wrong. So if you plot here, and this is 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. If at 5 o'clock, she is not at 10, she is even 9 or even 9.5 she is, she will immediately cross the alert line. And that time you will know that yes, the labor progress is not good. That is why it is always on alert line. So, these were the all 9 questions which we have covered. I hope you must have got the right answers and you must be satisfied with it. If you are not, if you have any query, please put down in the chat box. I'll get back to you as soon as possible. If your INI-CET has been good, very good, best of luck to you. If not, please don't lose hopes. Your major exam is on the way, NEET. Just be very thorough with all the topics that have been asked. And since the NEET has been postponed, utilize this time. Please don't go into the depth of the topic. Now, just revise what you have been revising already. If you plan for 3 revisions, go for 10 revisions. Don't go into the depth. Don't misuse this postponement. Utilize it and you'll come out with flying colors. Till then, bye-bye.